First of all, I'm pleased to be a member of a government currently pursuing a suite of legislation aimed at addressing an issue which has been at the forefront of moral, social, religious and political discourse in this country since the child abuse issue broke the surface of this idyllic society of our parents and forced us as a people to confront the demons embedded within and accept that all is not well when a modern democracy fails to afford constitutional protection so cherished by our citizens to almost 20% of our population. It reflects worse on us when those denied protection are the most innocent and vulnerable among us and are wholly incapable of protecting themselves. I'm speaking of our most treasured asset, our future, those who will carry the mantle of this nation in the future. The suite of legislation undertaken by this government, the enactment of which has been expedited by our specifically designated Minister for Children, Francis Fitzgerald TD, is aimed at addressing the protection of children in a real and meaningful way. And the jewel in the crown of the process is the introduction of the 31st Amendment to the Constitution, which will amend the Constitution and insert a new article, Article 42A, which will have the effect of enshrining the protection of children and expressly recognise children in their own right within the Constitution. In passing this bill, we are galvanising the protection of children and ensuring the right of every child to be afforded constitutional protection in their own right. In doing so, we are displaying a maturity and establishing ourselves as a nation where every citizen is truly cherished equally and entitled to enjoy all the rights conferred on us by our Constitution. We are truly implementing change. We are no longer paying lip service to the apparent revelations that came dripping slowly from a hidden Ireland where abusers and predators were at best ignored and at worst protected. And I'm not referring to any particular sector of society in saying this, as child abuse spans every socio-economic, cultural, religious and political boundary and is to be found everywhere where the light fails to shine. We as a government are succeeding where others have failed. We as a government are ceasing the practice of displaying shock and horror practiced by previous administrations at the horror stories and cases bursting onto the media, only to be forgotten about when the next big issue arose. Our Taoiseach, Mr. Enda Kenny, elevated the children's portfolio to front bench position as far back as 2007, being the first to give and recognise the important position children should be afforded in government, and again followed through in this important process by creating a new cabinet position for Minister for Children, which has been eminently filled by my party colleague, Francis Fitzgerald, who deserves great credit for tackling this gap absence in our legislation and constitution, whereby children and the most vulnerable among us were denied the protection available to others. The need for this protection has been highlighted by successful reports, including the Kilkenny incest case and subsequent investigations, the Constitutional Review Group, the All-Ireland Oireachtas Committee on the Constitution, the Roscommon incest and rape case, and subsequent the report in 2010, and the Joint Committee on the Constitutional Amendment on Children in 2010, as well as various clerical abuse tribunals. Yet almost 20 years have passed when we had money for everything without this gaping hole in society being addressed. Finally, it wasn't as if there were few incidents of abuse. Last year alone, of the 30,000 child protection and welfare concerns reported, 1,500 were confirmed cases of sexual, physical or emotional abuse, and that's not including the vastly more numerous welfare issues. Our Taoiseach, our Minister for Children and this government, does the nation a great service and deserves the support of this House in forging ahead with these various instruments of legislation which will finally afford protection to our children whose hopes and aspirations of a struggling but proud nation are in the palm of our hands. Thank you.
Thank you. I'll call on Deputy Patrick Deputy Donoghue.
Thank you very much, Cancola. I think it's entirely appropriate as the Minister sits there listening to this debate and moving this bill through the House that she has a copy of the Constitution in front of her there. Because I'm sure you may carry it with you all the time, but it's particularly appropriate to be here tonight. Because, of course, it is the Constitution itself that we're looking to change. And as we do this, I think it's appropriate to reflect on where the Constitution came from and the good that it has done the state to date. I think as we acknowledge the 75th anniversary of us, which Deputy O'Donovan did, it's very easy to forget sometimes what a brave and progressive document that was in the context of where Ireland stood then. It stood as a small country on the edge of a very fraught and uncertain Europe. And within that, there were many, many recognitions, many systems that were put into that body of work that have served our country very, very well and have stood the test of time. But as many other speakers have commented on it, the one group that wasn't referenced at all within it was, of course, children. And one other factor that that group had in common and that distinguished them is, unlike other groups that were referenced in that document, Children don't have the ability to organise themselves. Children don't have the ability to collectively come together and articulate what they're looking for in the way that many other groups do that were rightfully enumerated and called out in that document. Children don't choose the parents to which they're born to. Children don't choose the families into which they arrive. The environment is something that's a given for them, and they have to choose how to respond to it. And with that in mind, that is an omission within that document that has not served our country well, and that has had terrible consequences for children over different generations. And there's just three brief points I'd like to make in the context of that. The first one is that I know this is something the Minister has said herself. When we talk about children within the amendment that we're putting forward to the country, we're not just talking about children at risk. We're actually talking about all children. We're talking about making sure that them as a group and them as individuals are explicitly recognised within our constitution and that their rights are clearly called out. And this will have many, many consequences in the future that in truth, few of us can foretell what they're going to be. We don't know how they're going to develop and how they might crystallise. That can only be a good thing for that group that have not been recognised to date. The second point is that the number of children that we are talking about, despite the fact that I said there, who might be affected by this constitution in a material way, is thankfully a tiny number of children. But it is a number of children that we have not given the right protection to, and we have not given the right support to over the years. Which just leads on to the third brief point that I want to make, which is something that I think this amendment has done very, very well, is that the threshold of intervention that it sets is high enough that it will only be called in and triggered in a very, very exceptional number of cases where children are not just being let down by their families, but they're being afforded no form of protection at all and they desperately need support. But at the same time, the threshold is not so low that anybody out there that has concerns regarding an expansionist state or has any concerns here about the state trying to take the place of the children, take the place of parents, if they actually read the wording here of the amendment, they'll surely see, and I hope they'll see during the course of the campaign, that such fears are groundless and such fears won't be materialised. And I mentioned the amendment there. I think the best way I can finish up my own short contribution is actually by quoting some of the phrases here within the amendment that I think we all have done, but I hope the people do as they contemplate how they'll vote. And just one phrase I think is worthwhile emphasising. When in sub-article 2.1 we say the state as guardian of the common good shall by proportionate means as provided by law endeavour to supply the place of parents. And I'll just conclude in those points. What we're talking about here is the common good. A philosopher once said that the way you judge the maturity and the success of a democracy is by how they treat the most vulnerable. And what we're talking about here is an articulation of the common good that recognises the young people that need our help the most, who offer the clearest vision possible of what the common good looks like. And the phrase there, endeavour to supply the place of parents. The state is not looking to take the place of parents. It has no such ambition. It's not looking to do so. It's simply saying that in the case of those people that need our help the most, we'll realise the common good by giving them all the help that we can, and changing these words in this constitution will allow us to do that better in the future. Thank you, Karen Corbyn.